starten. Who am I? I work for Headcraft. I'm the team lead quality performance, so I was solution architect, but now I'm the nasty guy who continues complains about quality performance. I'm also the author of Mastering Headcraft 3, which is freely available on websites. I have 40 years of Java experience, and my big love is everything related to concurrency control, distributed computing. So Headcraft is the place to be. If you have questions, please don't hesitate to ask. Otherwise, just send me an email. I'm Peter Finken, so it's Hazelcast, so it should be quite easy to send me a second to help. So what's Hazelcast? Hazelcast is the leading open source Java in memory data compute grid. And our main goal is to simplify the development of scalable and highly available systems. So why should I use Hazelcast? Hazelcast is just a 3 megabyte JAR file. There are no other software dependencies, so you don't need to deal with version conflicts of software. You don't need to install software as well, so it's very easy to set up. And often, when you use different products, it's a whole hassle. You need to install all kinds of things to just slow everything down. It's a library, it's not an application and framework. So you determine your architecture. We do not determine your architecture. You're pretty free and what to do. Of course, we give advice how to do it well, but you are in charge of the architecture. We have Apache 2 license. It's free to use. There are no limitations. You can create as many data structures as you want. It can be as big as you want. You can create as many members and clusters as you want. So there are no limitations. We provide a whole bunch of distributed data structures. They're like atomic logs and degenerators, semaphore, forest, queues, and maps. You also provide a replicated map, a map reduce mechanism, transactional data structures. And the cool thing is that you can even create your own at the end of the presentation. I'll come back to that. So, what can I do with it? Normally, if you have an application, yeah, you start out, it runs on single box. The problem is that if you get more and more loads, the question is how are we going to deal with the load? Because, of course, you can scale up, just get more hardware, and you have more capacity. The problem is that you cannot add faster hardware indefinitely, because eventually it will just become too expensive. What you want to do is you want to scale out. Yeah, just add more machines to the same capacity, and just get more, for example, total amount of memory or total amount of CPU. And the cool thing is that because you have more machines, it's also easier to be highly available. So if a single machine fails, then there is enough backups available to restore all the data. This is a small test I did this week. We are going to do a lot of stuff for performance. So in coming releases, performance will be a lot better than this. But currently, for example, on a single node, we do almost 70,000 inserts per second. And we do 150,000 reads per second. With the complete default configuration, nothing special. There's a lot of things this can be true. And in this case, the 32 machines, I do almost 500,000 inserts per second and 1,000,000 reads per second. So that's quite a lot. If you use a traditional database, you'll not get these numbers. This is an example we made for the Java conference. It's a cluster of Raspberry Pi machines. Every Raspberry Pi has 512 megabytes of memory and a slow processor. But if you combine all these machines together, then you have a little supercomputer. And the cool thing is, with Hazelcast, it's very easy to combine the resources of all these little machines to a single big machine. Normally in production, you'll never use Raspberry Pi, so it's just a very fun thing to play with. But it shows you what you can do with it. Hazelcast can be used for a lot of different purposes. I think the most used purpose is caching. Yeah, normally if you need data, you go to the database, and every time you go to the database again, eventually the database will be overwhelmed for requests, so what you want to do is you want to cache it. Apart from that, we also provide a messaging solution. You can use data aggregation, cluster scheduling, and a whole lot of other things. The other thing is that you can also use HTTP session clustering. It's also very nice if you have a web application which needs to be highly available. There are a lot of companies using Hazelcast. There are a lot of e-commerce companies like Apple and eBay. Apple uses in total, I think, something like 600 members, and separated in 10 clusters. So they have 10 clusters of 60 members each. We have financial organizations like JP Morgan, telcos, and gaming companies. So we have a whole different, whole range of different types of customers. There are a whole bunch of open source projects using Hazelcast underneath the hood. AWS through Carbon, View Enterprise Service Bus, Vertex. So if you use the products, then indirectly you're also using Hazelcast. How often is Hazelcast being used? In April 2014, we had 3 million startups. And from 48,000 unique IP addresses, we have a call home mechanism, which when a system starts up, does ping back to the home. Then we know how often it's being used. We don't see everything, because it could be that it's disabled, or it could be that's behind firewall. So let's do some coding. To create a Hazelcast cluster, it's very simple. We have this line, Hazelcast instance AC is Hazelcast.new/Hazelcast instance. Now you get back a Hazelcast instance which is embedded within your JVM. In most cases, that's the way you want to work. You want to have the Hazelcast member embedded as part of the JVM. You don't want to have a separate cluster because it involves more remoting. Hazelcast can be configured in a lot of different ways. Most people use the XML configuration because, well, everybody wants to use XML. You can define everything here, network configurations, your maps and your queues. If you do not define your data structure in here, no problem, then you just use default settings. You don't need to define everything in the XML. We also have a programmatic API. It's very useful because XML is very static. Sometimes you want to have more dynamic behavior, and then it's very easy. You can also do programmatic configuration. So let's do a small demo. See, everybody can see this? Or should they make the phone a little bit bigger? Yeah, this is a little better. So what I'm going to show is a small demo application. Yeah, I don't know the program because it takes a little bit too much time, so I have a very small command line demo application. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start two of these instances. And you will see that after a few seconds, they will see each other. Takes a few seconds here. You can see the cluster is being formed and they see the other member. So I'm going to get back to this demo application. You're going to play around with the different features of Hazelcast. I think one of our most use structures is a map. If you start out, for example, I have a map here where I put in products. The problem is that this map is not thread safe. I cannot use this map by multiple threads from the same JVM. I can very easily fix that. Just change the implementation by current has map and I'm done. Yeah. Now I can use this product map by multiple threads from the same JVM. The problem is that you cannot access this map by multiple threads from different JVMs. In Hazelcast again, this is the change you make. Then you create your Hazelcast instance, and then from that Hazelcast instance you ask for your map. And you have to get back to the current map implementation, so we have a magic map in place. And this data structure is a distributed data structure. So let's demonstrate that. So here I have my two node cluster, and we have a little map in here called M. And what I'm going to do is, in this machine, I'm going to put one Peter. And as you can see, the value I put in one JVM is visible in the other JVM. We have a zillion configurations for the map. This is the biggest and most complicated data structure we have. These are just a few options. You can configure a time to live. Yeah, for example, all data longer than older than an hour needs to be evicted automatically to prevent overloading the system. You can create indexes. For example, a product has a name, but you quickly want to find the product based on name, so you create an index on it. So there are many settings you can play with. Let's give you a little bit of background information of how we make our system scalable and highly available. So by default, we chop up everything in 271 partitions. It's a configurable number, yeah, so you can put in a different number here. By default, it's 271. And what we do is we take the key, for example, and we calculate hash for the key, and we multiply on partition counts, and based on that, we find the partition ID. And every member in the cluster has a partition table, where it states like, hey, partition 5 needs to be at member 23, or partition 10 needs to be at member 2. And so every member in the cluster knows exactly where all data in the cluster is.
Distributed cluster table.
What did you say?
Is it distributed cluster table?
Yes. So let's start with a single member cluster. Yeah, so this member gets three partitions because I have not enough space to do 271. Now I add my second member, and he will automatically get one of the partitions. I add my third member, and he will also get one of the partitions. But the cool thing is that to guarantee high availability, we also make copies. Yeah, so in this case, for example, for member 3, the green primary partition is available on member 2 as backup. So if member 3 would fail, then the backup data is still available. So the system will automatically restore itself and will automatically restore the backup partition and make a new backup partition of the green data to make sure that there's again another backup available. A small demo. Let's clear the map first. And what I'm going to do, what I did is I just inserted 100 random items in this particular map. If I ask for the size, then of course I'll see 100. And if I ask for size here, then it's 100 as well. But if I ask how much data do you actually have on your machine, you have different methods just for demonstration purposes. Local size. 53. So this means if I ask here and the local size, I get 47. The cool thing is if I would now kill this first member, now member is killed, I ask here again, give me your size. You'll see it's still 100. If I ask for the local size, it's 100. So the data is automatically restored, automatically highly available, add more machines to the system for more capacity. You can create more backups if you want, by default you get one, but you can create up to 7 backups. Oops. We also have a multi-map implementation. Normally when you have a map, then you have single key, single value. Sometimes you want to have multiple values for a single key. You can do that in normal Java very simply, just change the value by collection and add the collection. The problem is if you do that in a distributed environment, and it could be that the whole collection is being stored on a different machine, and you want to add an item, and there are 1,000 items already in the collection, and the whole those 1,000 items, they need to be sent over the line to you, where you add that one item, and then 1,000 more items go back. So it's very inefficient. And apart from that, you also run into a lost update potentially. So that's why I have Multimap. It provides solutions to all these problems. So a small demo. This is the Multimap MM. And what I'm going to do is put Peter in here. Oops.
You need to run.
Yes. Peter. Peter. Yes. And then put one Talib. Talib is the founder of the company. And if I ask get one, you'll see Peter and Talib. And so that's the multi-map in action. We also provide a block queue implementation. In the blocking queue, it's very easy to create producer or consumer solutions. The problem is, of course, that a linked blocking queue is not a distributed data structure. So you cannot touch add data on one machine and take it from the other one. With Hashcast, it's very easy. Yeah, you create your Hashcast instance, then you get your queue, and you can use it as a normal regular blocking queue. So a small demo. So here I have my queue. Take from LLC, that item I just put on the queue, is available in your member. The cool thing is, it's a blocking queue, so if I do a date without an item being available, then I call blocks. If I now do a queue.offer item 2, you'll see that yes. The item which is now being put on releases the blocking of one traffic. We also have a topic. A topic is like a JMS topic. Only it's very lightweight. Cool thing is that it's completely embedded in the Hazelcast environment, so you don't need to install a message broker or something. Publishing a message is very simple. Just call the topic to publish message. Subscribing to a topic is also very easy. Just register a message listener, and you will be up to date to all the messages published. We also have a client, because sometimes you want to have all members in the cluster to be equal. Yeah, everybody's going to take care of the load, everybody's going to store data. But sometimes you just want to access data, you want to be a client. Now, we have solutions for different languages. For example, we have, of course, we have a Java client. We also have a C++ and C# client. And you can also use a Memcached protocol to talk to the Hazelcast cluster. The other thing is that clients, they can be smart or they can be dumb. If you have a smart client, it knows about the partition tables, so it knows about all members in the cluster. So if I'm going to do a map.get for Peter, then it knows, hey, Peter is on partition 25. Partition 25 is on member 16, so I'm going to send my request immediately to machine 16, because he knows the data is living there. Sometimes you don't want to do that, because if you have many members or many clients in your cluster, then every client is going to open ports to every member in the cluster, so it doesn't eventually doesn't scale. Sometimes you want to be fast, then you make it smart. Sometimes you want to have a very scalable system with a very big number of clients, then you make it dumb, because the dumb client, it just has a random connection to a member in the cluster, doesn't know which one, and then it will just send a request to that member in the cluster. And that member needs to take care, oh, this is not my data, I need to reroute it to the machine with dust container data, so it puts more pressure on the cluster and introduces more latency. Creating a Hazelcast client is very simple. So Hazelcast client, the new Hazelcast client. And the cool thing is that the thing you get back is just a regular Hazelcast instance. So only at the point where you're creating your client, then you need to know, okay, it's a client or is it just a Hazelcast member? But when the object is being instantiated after that, it's just a regular Hazelcast instance. Of course, you need to take care of in the architecture that it makes sense. From a programming point of view, it's very simple. A little bit of background information about communication, network communication. There are two important phases for a Hazelcast cluster. The first phase is the cluster discovery phase. So you start up, you need to figure out, am I going to be creating a new cluster or am I going to join a cluster? Well, we have three, well, I lie a little bit. There are 2+1 discovery options here. One of them is multicast. Multicast is very nice for development, for demos, but in most production environments, multicast is not available. So the other option to use is TCP IP-based clustering. And what happens here is that you have a list of well-known members. It's best to have multiple well-known members, but you need to have a list of them. And if a member joins the cluster, it checks the list of well-known members if one of them is available. If it is, it joins the cluster. And then we also have AWS clustering. What happens behind the scenes, we just log into the Amazon console, read out all private IP addresses, we apply some filtering, and those private IP addresses are the well-known members for TCP-based clustering. So we only have 2+1. After the discovery phase is done, it's just regular TCP-based communication. A little bit more advanced Hazelcast. Well, I think this is very advanced. When you create a distributed application, especially when tooling is very easy, it's very easy to create it, but it's even easier to create an application which doesn't perform. In this case, for example, I have a piece of business logic, and for that logic, I always need to have a lock, it's called some lock, I need to have a counter called some counter, and I need to have some data in a hash map, some person. The problem is that in production, it will look like this. Yeah, I have one member
where the sum log is being stored, another member is doing some counter, and then even a different member is doing some person. So my data is scattered all over the system. So if I need to do something with the data, then there's a lot of remote calls going on. It makes it very slow. The problem here is that the name is being used to identify an object, but it's also being used to determine the actual partition. And what we added in HashiCorp 3 is that if you use name at partition key, then the whole thing is being used as the identifier, but the partition key is the part determining the partition where your data is going to be stored. So in this case, I can solve that problem. So my log is some log at foo, my counter is some counter at foo, and my person object is some person at foo. So in production, it will look like this. Yeah, I have a member, I don't know which one it is. In this case, it's two. Two is responsible for partition foo. And therefore, some log, some counter, and some person, they all fall in the same partition. Yeah, so this is one of the most fundamental steps you need to get right if you want to write a distributed application, because otherwise you'll be doing remote calls all over the place. You will not see this in your local development environment, because probably there are no performance tests. But as soon as you go into production, you will immediately figure out why the hell is HashiCorp so slow. Well, it could be that HashiCorp is not slow, but your architecture is introducing a lot of extra latencies. You can also create new objects which are being put in the same partition as an existing object. So in this case, I have an existing atomic long C1, and I'm going to create a new atomic long C2. Ah, yes. And I just use the partition key of C1 to determine the partition key of C2. Now C1 and C2 both fall in the same partition. The executor. We provide implementation of the executor service of Java. And this makes it possible to drop in a task which will be executed anywhere in the cluster. It's very nice, but not always practical, because you also want to have control on where data is being executed. You can say, well, I want this task to be executed on a partition, on a particular partition. For example, I could create a task which is being executed on partition foo, the partition we just talked about. So it makes it very easy to control where task is being sent to. We also have the option to execute a task on a particular member of the cluster. We also provide synchronization options, for example, the future. Futures are quite okay, but the problem is that it's a blocking call. Yeah, you do your future call and then you do a get, and your thread is being blocked till the call completes. Often it doesn't scale very well. That's why we also provide an execution callback. With the execution callback, it's possible to say like, okay, I'm going to execute this task, but when it completes, I want you to do this. So then you have a fully asynchronous call. One of the things I'm working on is the completable future for Java 8. It's the same mechanism as the execution callback. The only one of the things we need to look at is providing sufficient back pressure that you don't overload the system with requests. That's one of my tasks. A small demo. So what I'm going to demonstrate here is I'm going to start out with a single member in my cluster. So let's kill this one. And I have an executor in here. It's called E1. And I'm going to execute some nonsense task, 16 pieces of them, and each task is going to take 1 second. So I have one thread, 16 tasks, each task is going to take 1 second. Therefore, we need to wait 16 seconds. This is very slow. I want to speed up. So what can I do? Of course, I can just create more threads. And if my machine has enough capacity, then that's fine. So let's use the E2. E2 has two threads. Load 16.1. So because there are now two threads, it will go twice as fast. Because two threads are now processing it. But I want to go even faster. I have one machine, it has two cores. But I want to have many machines. I just want to scale up. Okay, no problem. So I'm starting my second machine. Now, because the tasks do nothing else than sleeping, they are not CPU-bound tasks or something, I can easily start this open on this current machine. But normally, you want to have real different machines that take share in the load. So let's do it again. E2, And now you will see that both machines are participating in the load. You want more capacity, just add more machines. Locking. We provide a whole bunch of low-level data structures. We provide the Java util lock implementation. We provide transactional map get for updates. If you know Oracle with Slack for update, or PostgreSQL or MySQL, they all provide similar construct. We also have the map lock. The cool thing about the lock, it's also a distributed data structure. So imagine that I have claimed a lock, and now I die. Then the system will automatically see that and say, oh, Peter has died. He will never be able to release the lock himself. So let's release the lock for him, because he will not be able to. Otherwise, the lock is dead, and every call to it will deadlock. So that's one situation. But now imagine that so I own a lock, and now he is the one that stores the lock. And he is the one that carries the partition, and he dies. Because the lock is being replicated, he has a copy of that lock. So the system just continues as if nothing happened. So a lock is a distributed and highly available data structure. A small demo. Let's clear my map. M.lock1. So what I did here is I have locked key 1 on the map M. If I'm going to do a put, then the call is not completing, it's blocked because the lock is old. If I do the unlock, you'll see the call completes. Yeah, so locking in hashcards is quite simple. You can also define timeouts. So if you do a lot of locking in all kinds of different directions, it's very easy to run a deadlock. If you define timeouts, then you don't have a problem. That's often the best thing you can do anyway. So let's deal with some race problems and using the lock API. So in this case, we are going to transfer some money into a bank account. And I'm sure that nobody wants to lose money on their bank account. So what I do here is the first line is I do a get, where I load the account. Then I change the balance, and then I write back the change to the Hazelcast map. This is a very important concept to understand. It's not like Hibernate, where you just change your data, and it will automatically be flushed to the database when the session closes. In Hazelcast, you need to put the data back into the data structure. In this case, there's a race problem, because the get and the put are not an atomic call. So if it happens concurrently, then it can be that you lose data, or maybe you don't lose data, you don't lose money, and maybe somebody subtracted it and then you don't see it, which is also good. One way of solving it is using a lock on the map, yeah, the one I just demonstrated. In this case, I do accounts, lock account ID, and finally clause, I unlock it. And of course, I do a get and a put. The problem here is that I have four remote calls going on, potentially, yeah, depending on your partitioning. I have the lock and the unlock, two remote calls, and a put and a get. That can be done better. So let's try to do that. Let's go for an optimistic approach. Yeah, in this case, I create my for loop. I read out my old account. Then I create a new account based on that old account. It will be a copy. I change the value on that new account. And then I write back into that map, replace this value under the condition that the old value is still there. So it's better because there are only two remote calls involved. The problem is that this is still not as good as it could be. And this has to do with a fundamental thinking problem we have. Normally, when you write an application, especially one with a database, you have your database, it contains the data. You have your application layer, it contains the business logic. And normally you say, okay, select, 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 modify, 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 insert or update when the transaction completes. That's the usual way of working. And the problem here is that you do not want to send your data to the function. You want to send your function to the data. So in that sense, a stored procedure is a lot better performance-wise than just doing a select and then doing an update. In Hazelcast, it's very easy. You can write a function, and you can send that function to the machine containing the data where it will be executed. So in Hazelcast, it's very easy to send a function to your data. In this case, I have I wrapped the optimistic call. Yeah, you saw it on a few slides before. I've wrapped it in a task. In this task, I am going to execute on the executor service, and I am going to say execute on key owner. Now this task is going to be executed on the partition that owns that particular piece of data. So now you have your call, and it's being sent exactly to the right machine where it's being executed. This is very efficient. But it can be even more efficient. One of the things we provide is called the entry processor. And with the entry processor, you have direct access to the data stored in that map entry. Yeah, so in this case, what I do, I create my balance processor and the process method, which is the only thing really interesting here. I do e.getValue, so you get back the account which is stored there, and dot balance plus is amount. So this way, I do not need to read it and write it, because that's already done behind the scenes for you in a much faster way than with a regular map and a regular map.get and a regular map.put. So this is much more efficient. It can even be more efficient, and I'm going to explain it in a little bit. Using the entry processor is also very simple. I create my entry processor object, and then I say to the accounts, execute on key, where I provide my key, the account ID, and the processor. So now the task is being sent exactly to that machine, where it's being executed in a single call. When you store data in Hazelcast, there are different ways to do it. If you store data, which needs to be replicated, it needs to go over the line anyway. So you need to be able to serialize the data. We have two options, because if the data is being sent over the line and it's being arriving at the other machine, you can leave it in its binary format. But you can also say, like, hey, I don't want to have it in a binary format at all. I want immediately when the data is being received at the other end, that the object is being deserialized and I have my object back. And you can do that using the object in memory format. And this is very efficient if you do a lot of things with predicates, because what happens with a predicate is that the predicate is being sent to that map, and it will iterate over certain items depending on your query, and it will need access to the actual stored data. But if the data is being stored in a binary format, for every call you do on the predicate, you need to deserialize the data, then you have your object. But if the data is already available in object format, then you can just get a reference to the data, and then it's very fast because you skip the whole serialization part. The other one that can really benefit from it is the entry processor. Because what happens here is that if I select the object in memory format, the value which is being exposed here, e.getValue, is just the value which is being stored in memory on the Hazelcast node. So the change you make is just an in-memory change without serialization. So it's very efficient. So that's the most efficient way to make a change in Hazelcast. It's very important to get this kind of stuff right, because it can really give you your application a big performance boost. Let me see. The SPI. It's not one of our most well-known features. It's something new of Hazelcast 3. We have a lot of distributed data structures, like maps and logs and whatever, but they are all built on a lower level infrastructure. That lower level infrastructure deals with operations, retrying operations, backups, migrating of partitions, and that kind of stuff. And what we did is we said, okay, we are going to expose this API, SPI, to the end user. So this API is the one we use internally to create our own stuff, but we expose it to you to create your own distributed data structures. So you have now the ability to create your own distributed data structures if you do not like the ones we provide, because we cannot provide everything. And an example of this is that, I think it was a year ago, I created a distributed actors implementation on top of the SPI, because an actor is just an object that lives somewhere in the cluster that maybe has a thread, it has a message box, a mailbox, a state. What I did, the mailbox is just a queue. It's a blocking queue of Hazelcast, automatically replicated. The state of the actor is being stored in a map, a distributed map, which is backed up by Hazelcast. And as soon as the member which contains that actor dies, on a different member, it says, hey, okay, I just received this partition. I need to do stuff here. I know that you have an actor service. Let's restart all your actors which have died in the other machine. So your actor just freely floats around within the environment. This is extremely cool because it gives you unlimited possibilities what you can do with Hazelcast. The serialization API, I already told you the data needs to be sent over the line. And of course, we provide the serializable and externalizable by default. It works, but it's quite slow. It has some issues, especially that the binary content of serialization is not always the same. So this gives problems, for example, with map.replace. And it's also quite big because all metadata of the class is still bound within that in that block. So you have a lot of extra metadata which is being sent over the line. That's why we have a whole bunch of different pluggable serialization options. And one of them is the stream serializer. And with the stream serializer, of course, you can create your own implementation. But you can also say, like, hey, I'm a lazy guy. I want to spend my time a little bit better. Let's take one of the well-known serialization libraries like Cryo, JacksonSmile, Protobuf, or whatever else is out there. A little while ago, I was sent to a customer, a big web shop. And they had a problem that for the Christmas holidays, they were not able to keep all data, their products in memory. And we got a bunch of their products, and they were on average, they were between the 10 and the 20 kilobyte big. So that was a really big issue for them, because if they cannot keep everything in memory, their website slows down, and the response times increase, and they immediately lose money. So they said, okay, you need to come and you need to help us. So we went in. And I solved the problem already the day before I went in, so we just needed to implement and test it. What we did is we introduced Cryo, and Cryo takes care of serialization. In this case, I started out with regular Cryo. On average, I got a 60% size reduction. When I enabled the compression within Cryo, I got an 80% size reduction. So they could keep 5 times as much data in memory as they could before, just with a very small change. This is the change I made. You create a serializer configuration. You say, for this product class, I want to override any serialization you are doing out of the box. I just want to use the product serializer, which in this case is a cryo-based one. Then I just create my Hazelcast configuration based on this serializer config. So this way, I can just override the serialization behavior which is available in your class. So it's very easy to tune. One of the new features of Hazelcast 3.2 is the MapReduce implementation. For example, if you want to aggregate data on your map, in this case, I want to do a sum of the balances of all my accounts. In this case, accounts.map new account sum mapper, reduce account sum reduce. In this case, I get back a result of all the sum of my balances. Enterprise first community. We have support contracts. Yeah, so if you have problems and you have a support contract, depending on the one support contract you have, you get support within a certain amount of time. We have elastic memory. If you have a lot of data in memory, like more than in most cases 10 to 15 gigabytes of heap, then the garbage collector start to be annoying because it needs to iterate over all the memory. And that's why you have an off-heap storage solution. So it's still within memory, but it's not visible for the JVM. Therefore, the garbage collector does not suffer from it. We have a fine-grained security solution and the management center. The management center, you can see inside of a cluster what's going on. It's very convenient for the DevOps guys. The future. I'm currently working on a project called the Stabilizer. It makes it very easy to create distributed data structures and to test them. And especially testing it is very complicated because how can I start my machines? How can I wait till they've completed? How can I distribute my jars? How can I run a JUnit-like test on it? And with Stabilizer, it takes care of that. It even has built-in support for profiling. And we are going to take it to a whole new level. We have a lot more performance tuning, a lot more things, so you can already test very easily if your algorithm or if your approach does scale at all. We are also going to provide topologies. With topologies, it's possible to create different layouts for your partition, for your partitions. For example, I have very big beefy boxes with lots of CPU power. Okay, then I have a topology beefy box. And I have another topology called big memory because it contains machines with huge quantities of memory. And I want my maps to be part of the big memory topology, and I want my executors to be part of the beefy box topology. Dynamic creation. Currently, you need to define all data structures up front. Either you define it in XML or you're going to use default. But it would be nice if you can define new configurations on the fly. So we are going to provide that as well. The map of maps, which puts you in the same space as Cassandra, and tiered storage. Currently, it's possible to offload data to, for example, database, but it's all manual work. Yeah, we have map loader and map store interface you need to implement, and that's how you can get data, for example, from a database or a file system. But tiered storage is going to take care of that for you out of the box. So you just overflow to disk, and maybe you have different layers of disk capacity and disk speed. Maybe you have a solid state disk, maybe you have a Hadoop cluster for real slow but really big data. So that's going to be one of the features we are going to provide in the future. So are there any questions? Yeah? When you add new nodes, then the new node in the cluster doesn't have any partitions, and it will slowly start to receive partitions of the other members in the cluster.
So you replicate some data from all clusters?
Yes.
And how quick happens?
It depends on the your partition size, because if you have 271 partitions, and you have every partition has 10 megabytes of memory, it goes quick. But if every partition has hundreds megabytes of memory, it goes slower. So you need to... Okay, that's a very good one. The calls that do that are being parked till the backup is. When you add a new machine, the calls will just continue, and the backup will automatically see like, oh, I'm not yet completely up to sync, so let's try to get in sync.
Okay, and if I have like few gigabytes of data,
yeah,
so it will take some time. Yeah,
it depends, because it's not like you are going to send the whole memory in one go. You're going to do it in little batches, depending on your partition size. So you do it a partition at a time.
Okay, and all data is stored in memory, right?
So yes.
No disk operations?
Currently not. That's the tiered storage solution. Next.
Hey. On your example, you show that when you insert 100 elements into map, you gracefully shut down one node.
Very good question.
Yeah, and what if you will kill one node?
It's the same principle. What happens is that the cluster will figure out, hey, I'm not able to connect to that guy anymore. There's something wrong with it. So it tries a few more times, and eventually a timeout expires. Okay, apparently he's dead. Let's start to make the system healthy again. Let's start to make the primaries, which he had. Let's look them up in the cluster. Let's make them primary again, because the backups need to become primary. And let's make copies of those new primaries to other members.
So the data on this not gracefully shut down node, if will we lose this data? Or
It depends on your configuration. If you have an out-of-box configuration, then if you make a write on a map, you get the guarantee that if the write completes, the backup is already done. So at that point in time, after you call completes, you can be sure, like, kill that member, I have my backup. If you do an asynchronous write, which you can also configure, then like, if you are unhappy enough just to miss, to have not have that write in the other machine yet, then you lose data.
So how can Hazel cluster survive not graceful restart data in cluster?
How do you mean?
How would Hazelcast data in cluster survive not graceful restart?
That the data is managed by the cluster, and the cluster will automatically make sure that all data, if there's a primary which gets lost, that all the backups are being, either new copies are being made or the backups are being restored to primary.
Yeah, but if I will shut down whole cluster.
Ah, yes, that's a good one. Then it's end of story.
In any case of reservation, there are always possible situation when something very bad happens. For example, if you have two copies in cluster, then in very, very rare cases, maybe even almost impossible, but still it can happen theoretically. Both nodes holding the data could, for example, cradump. And So I just want to say that sometimes loss of data should happen in your production.
It can happen. You can configure the number of backups. That we have up to, I think, 6 or 7. Mm-hmm. And you can also say, like, I want this backup to be part of a different data center. Mm-hmm. So if that whole data center goes down for whatever reason, then the backups are still available in that data center.
Mm. I just want to ask, how frequent is this situation in production, by your experience? And also, I just want to ask how real applications work around the situation or fix after, recover after such situations.
What we see in practice is that even if a whole cluster fails, of course, it's extremely annoying to the end user, but we'll have backups available. We'll advise that you have backups available of your data, and that you offload your data to a database or some other more durable mechanism. So most data we keep in memory should be considered as volatile. And if you really want to be durable, you need to copy it to a more safer mechanism.
Last one question.
What about latency? So how quick response, like simple?
It really depends on the amount of data you do in a call. It really depends on the network. And for example, EC2, it varies a lot. If you do it in our own test cluster, then it's very, very little. It's a millisecond.
You have some numbers.
To be very honest, I don't have much numbers about the. I know about throughput because we're currently putting all that stuff in place, but I don't have numbers currently about latencies. To exchange support, to add support for exchanging data between nodes in a cluster. In what sense do I need support? Or do we need support? UDP, yes. I'm playing with different ideas. Very short, the idea is the following. Every CPU should get its own socket. If you send data for a particular partition, you immediately send it on a port of that particular CPU, because every CPU you're listening to a particular, how do you call it, a socket. This way you can immediately shoot data for partition in the right socket. And I'm playing around with UDP and TCP/IP, because TCP/IP is overhead. And I want to figure out how much overhead there is. And then we can play around with UDP to see if it's a real good replacement. Of course, currently, performance is bound by especially the whole TCP/IP stack.
Hey guys, thank you very much for questions. Thank you, Peter.
Okay.